أشراف مطلب وطالبه لله أكرام من يمشي على قدم. العلم نور مبين يستضيء به أهل السعادات والجهال في الظلم.
طيب إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله، أما بعد. طيب طيب last week we stopped at الاجتهاد. And the last point we took was what? شروط الاجتهاد. شروط الاجتهاد. What are from the شروط of الاجتهاد? The conditions of اجتهاد. طيب. That the مجتهد knows آيات الأحكام. طيب. The mujtahid is certain that he's given, okay, that he has knowledge of the mas'ala that he's given. Naam, the mujtahid has to know the nasakh from the mansukh, the abrogated verses or ahadith from those ahadith or the verses that haven't been abrogated. Otherwise, he will give a hukum on something that has been abrogated and that has been changed. Now, he has to know ilm al-hadith, at the very least, the mustalahat, and siha, what is authentic and what is not authentic, what can be used as hujjah proof and what can't be used as proof. Luga, the Arabic language, he has to know the Arabic language, because the sharia obviously was revealed in the Arabic language. And he has to also know usul al-fiqh. And from usul al-fiqh, he has to know, or the reason why he has to know usul al-fiqh is he has to know دلالات الألفاظ, those things that wordings that are used in the Sharia, what they point towards, from عام, general, خاص, specific, مطلق, unrestricted, مقيد, restricted, ناسخ والمنسوخ, and so on and so forth. الأمر والنهي, and what an أمر command brings about, what a نهي brings about. طيب. نعم, he also excellent. He also needs to know where there's إجماع and where there isn't إجماع. So, or the benefit of that is that if a person gives a fatwa on a mas'ala that there's إجماع on, he contradicts إجماع, and that is haram to contradict إجماع. طيب, فضل الله. سامحني. نعم, he needs to know how to derive rulings from the أحكام of the Sharia. He needs to have the knowledge that helps him or allows him to do istinbat, to take derive rulings. It is not enough that he has knowledge of these things, because sometimes a person may have knowledge of them, lakin he doesn't know how to do istinbat. What else? Sisters? He has to know the am and the khas. Naam, he has to know the am and the khas. Usul al-fiqh. What else? Naam, excellent. Did we mention that last week? Did we study that? Naam, he has to know the maqasid of the sharia, the objectives of the sharia, and a lot of it is built on that. A lot of the mujtahid's work is built upon knowing the maqasid of the sharia, the objectives of the sharia, because when he's given a mas'ala, he might not know the hukum of it, lakin he knows that the sharia cannot command with that due to X, Y, Z. Excellent. He has to know the waqi' that he is given the fatwa in. Also, the mas'ala that he's given the fatwa in. Al-hukmu ala shay' fur'un an tasawwurihi. If you want to give a ruling on something, you need to know the surah to the mas'ala first and foremost. طيب, أحسنتم. Today, inshallah, we'll start or we'll continue with the al-ijtihad, and then we'll go into taqleed and then finish off the book, inshallah. يقول الشيخ رحمه الله والاجتهاد قد يتجزأ في باب واحد من أبواب العلم أو في مسألة من مسائله. طيب. Last week we studied that ijtihad is of two types. What were they? Mutlaq and juz'i. Mutlaq was what? When the mujtahid can derive rulings from the whole of the sharia. Not a specific chapter. مثلا not tahara or not al-buyu' or al-fara'id, not specific to any one chapter. Lakin, if you give him any mas'ala in any site or any chapter, then he'll be able to derive a ruling. The juz'i was what? Al-ijtihad al-juz'i was what? Or the mujtahid al-juz'i was the one that gives you, he's reached the level of ijtihad, the mujtahid. He's got all of those things, the conditions that you've just been mentioning now. However, he specializes in one particular mas'ala. So fara'id, for example. He can make ijtihad in fara'id. Or he can make ijtihad in nikah. So that is the two types. For example, now, what happens is, in dirasa academia, academic studies, what happens is, a person, after completing the normal BA, they go into master, sah, and then they go into PhD. More often than not, some of the types of masters that are available for people to do, or that people do, is that they do a dissertation or research on one particular mas'ala. And then the same goes for the doctorate, the PhD. So that person spends 4 years, or the person spends 4 years or so on one mas'ala. So it can be categorized or split up into different sections or different parts. So a person can be a mujtahid in a chapter from the chapters of knowledge or a mas'ala from the masail of knowledge. A mas'ala from the masail of knowledge. طيب. And that is the opinion of the Jumhur al-Ulama. Tajazza'u al-Ijtihad. Tajazza'u al-Ijtihad huwa qawlu jumhur ahl al-ilm. And then there are those from Ahl al-Ilm that say, la, it doesn't. Ijtihad is one thing and one component. So if a mujtahid cannot do ijtihad in every single mas'ala, then he cannot be called a mujtahid. Then the Shaykh rahimahullah says, ma yalzamu al-mujtahid, that which is befitting or binding upon the mujtahid. Yalzamu al-mujtahid an yabdula juhdahu fi ma'rifat al-haq. First and foremost, it is wajib for the mujtahid to give it his utmost in trying to know the haq in this, in any one mas'ala. The mas'ala that he's given by looking in the Quran and the Sunnah and the Ijma' and so on and so forth. ثُمَّ يَحْكُمُ, and then he gives the ruling بِمَا ظَهَرَ اللَّهُ, in that which is clear to him. So he does ijtihad and the ruling that he gives is based on that which is clear to him. بِمَا ظَهَرَ اللَّهُ فَإِنْ أَصَابَ فَلَهُ أَجْرًا فَإِنْ أَصَابَ أَيَّ الْحَقِّ فَإِنْ أَصَابَ الْحَقِّ. If he has attained the haqq, or he has achieved the haqq, or he's reached the haqq, and his mas'ala is according to the Quran and the Sunnah is correct, then he has two rewards. Ajrun ala ijtihadihi. Why does he have two rewards? Ajrun ala ijtihadihi. He is given one ajr due to his ijtihad, the effort that he has exerted in trying to attain this religious ruling. Wa ajrun ala isabati al-haq. And he has an ajr, a reward for actually being correct. So he has two ajr, one for being correct and one for even being able to be in that position of being a mujtahid. لِأَنَّ فِي إِصَابَةِ الْحَقِّ إِظْهَارٍ لَهُ وَعَمَلًا بِهِ. Why? Because لِأَنَّ فِي إِصَابَةِ الْحَقِّ. Why is he rewarded with two? Because by being correct and giving the correct ruling, إِظْهَارًا لَهُ وَعَمَلًا بِهِ. So by a person giving the correct ruling, then he has given the truth, he has made the truth apparent. And therefore people can act upon that truth, upon the haqq. So he has made the haqq apparent, and by way of making apparent, people are able to apply that haqq. وَإِنْ أَخْطَأَ لَكِنْ, if he makes a mistake, فَلَهُ أَجْرٌ وَاحِدٌ, he only has one reward. وَالْخَطَأُ, so he has one reward for what? For ijtihad, for his striving. فَلَهُ أَجْرٌ وَاحِدٌ. وَالْخَطَأُ مَغْفُورٌ لَهُ, لَكِنْ his خَطَأ, his mistake, he's pardoned, he's excused. طيب. لقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, due to the hadith of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, إذا حكم الحاكم فاجتهد, if the حاكم or the قاضي gives a حكم, فاجتهد, and he gives اجتهاد, ثم أصاب, and he gives the correct ruling, فله أجران, then he has two rewards. وإن حكم فاجتهد. لكن if he gives a ruling and after striving ثم أخطأ and then he makes a mistake فله أجر أي أجر واحد, then he has only one reward, and he has only one reward. وإن لم يظهر له, لكن if he doesn't have clarity on what the correct opinion is, he doesn't know which is closer to the truth. ولم يظهر له الحكم if the حق يعني the ruling is not clear to him, وجب عليه توقف, it is wajib for him to refrain from giving a fatwa, refrain from giving a hukum. مثلا there's a mas'ala that is given to him, he says Allahu a'lam, he can't give a hukum. لماذا? Why? He doesn't know the hukum. لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها, he doesn't know the حكم. وجاز التقليد حينئذ للضرورة. وجاز حينئذ أو وجاز وجاز التقليد and تقليد or blind following in that specific situation is permissible. لكن why? للضرورة, due to the necessity. طيب. On this مسألة there was homework last week. What was the homework? What was the مسألة that you had to look over? Is every mujtahid correct? هل كل مجتهد مصيب أم لا? طيب. إخواني, would you want to say his mujtahid is what? Is he مصيب? Is he correct or not correct? I want you guys, you brothers, to give one opinion and the sisters to give one opinion and then defend each opinion. Which one do you want to go with? He can make a mistake. So the mujtahid can give an ijtihad and he's not a musib. طيب. So the sisters, the brothers say that the mujtahid, la, he's got a his ijtihad. Hakim, you want to go against them? Hakim, you want to go against them? طيب. So the brothers are saying that the mujtahid is not musib, huh? صح? He's not correct in every case. Do you guys agree or disagree? You agree. طيب. إخواني, I want you to adopt the second opinion. I want the sisters to adopt the first opinion. Go on. You disagree. Even better. Okay. So, إخواني, why do you agree or why do you all say that the مجتهد is not مصيب? So you're saying كل مجتهد ليس بمصيب. Every مجتهد is not correct. What's that with the hand at half hand? La, you can go against it. And the ijma hasn't been binding yet. It's not binding. They're all alive. Man qarat al asr. You disagree. So you believe every mujtahid is correct. طيب. So and the sisters also said the same thing, sah? So you're with the sisters. Anta min al nisa' li fi hadhihi al mas'ala. طيب. Yeah. I asked everyone to do homework. So I want you guys said that every mujtahid is a musib at the beginning, sah? Every mujtahid is correct in his ijtihad. Okay, would you believe then? That he's not a musib. Okay. Take the opinion that he is a musib and you take the opinion that he's not a musib and defend that. That he's not a musib. And the sisters defend that he's a musib. Every mujtahid is correct. طيب, why do you think every mujtahid is not correct? إخواني. Because of the hadith. Which hadith? The one that is correct will get two rewards, and the one that is not correct will get one reward. It shows that not every mujtahid will get it. The opinion he can be incorrect. Okay. There's only one correct answer. Huh? صحيح. طيب فليس كل مجتهد مصيب then. طيب. Sisters, you all heard their evidence in, sah? How do you counter that? أحسنت. نعم. And the Prophet answered never. نعم. طيب, so they use that as evidence, and obviously, as you know, the Sharia, you have to understand it as a whole. So they said that the Hadith of Bani Qurayza, when the Prophet ﷺ said to the companions, "Do not pray Asr until you get to Bani Qurayza," right? He sallallahu alaihi wasallam obviously gave them that word, gave them the Hadith. Then on the way there, the time for Asr came, and they had not yet reached Bani Qurayza. Some of them prayed and said the Prophet only wanted us to hurry up. Some of them said, "La, we're not going to pray until we get there, because the Prophet simply said, don't pray until you get there." The Prophet answered when they came back, so these ones prayed and those ones didn't pray. When they came back and they told the Prophet ﷺ what happened, he did not rebuke them. The sisters are saying the fact that he did not rebuke them, it shows that they were both correct, because there was a qa'idah we took, ta'khir al-bayan and waqt al-hajati, la naqul la yajuz, we don't say la yajuz, la yaqa'u fi haqq al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or la yaqa'u min al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Prophet would not do that sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. طيب, they've countered your argument. Would you answer that? That's not what we're doing here. We're talking about, is he musib or not? Fadal Mubarak.
He only showed that, obviously, as he says, that, you know, that they have ta'awud, and there's ta'awud sa'ad in this salah. So therefore, it doesn't necessitate that there was a right or wrong. I mean, it doesn't necessitate that they were correct, the fact that they didn't review them. He only showed that there's ta'awud sa'ad, and for that reason, you know, a person allowed to act upon what is God and the language that this is haq.
Okay, so one of the brothers replied with, say, did you hear that? Yeah, so he's saying, la, the fact that he did not rebuke them doesn't show that they weren't in the wrong. How do you counter that? If they were wrong, they would have had to tell them. Ahsant, they would have had to tell them, because what was connected to it was ibadah. If they had made a mistake and they'd done their ta'wil, khalas. The Prophet ﷺ said, okay, do it now, but lakin, don't forget you were wrong, because it's connected to their salah. And salah is ibadah, one of the greatest ibadat. طيب, أحسنتي. طيب, Usama. How? How is their specific? How is their one specific or general? And or how is their one specific? And how is the hadith general? They use the general hadith.
The general hadith, but
which does not go into the ijtihad of every single mujtahid. So, but they're saying to you, here we have mujtahidun from the Sahaba that made ijtihad. Some said this and some said that. Some said we're going to pray on the way, some said we're going to pray there. When it got back to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he did not rebuke them. La, it's nothing to do with the qawl al-sahaba here. Nothing to do with mutlaq or muqayyad here. We have a mujtahid that done ijtihad during the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the Prophet ﷺ did not rebuke them. So the sisters are up, got the up hand now. Go on.
I think they're both correct from a place, but it's ultimately one correct answer. But
they're both correct from one angle.
From one angle, but it's ultimately one correct answer. And from this hadith, one is pardon, so they weren't rebuked. It's been allowed for, but there's a pardon behind it.
There's a pardoning behind it, but they'll accept that, because even this hadith shows that they're pardoned. That's not the issue. The fact that they're pardoned is not the issue, because they're agreeing with you here. They're saying to you, yes, even the hadith, إِذَا اجْتَهَدَ الحاكم the حكم الحاكم even in this hadith that is in the month on the matan there's he's excused for that.
Is it because the amr of the Prophet was only temporary for the Sahabas and after they came back?
منسوخ.
Yeah, basically.
No, what's the tariq for the منسوخ then? From the sugar that.
Carry on that obligation again.
Go wider, yani broaden your horizons, look at other things, think of other things and that you can refute them with. They are millions gone. It's 2-1 to them now, you know that. Go on. They can argue what? They have argued that you haven't brought anything back. You can have
two. I'm just trying to take the term of the Sunnah where perhaps two companions.
Two correct opinions. So the haqq is two.
So you're saying the
hadith of Bani Qurayda, there was ta'wil, you're saying?
Yeah, I'm saying it's
okay. And one was stronger than the other.
The Sahaba, their ijtihad only affected themselves. Each one did it on each side of themselves. But in other cases.
Isma, did you guys review the Masala? Because if you reviewed the Masala, you would have had about 10 arguments to refute them with. Who revised the Masala? Put your hand up if you revised the Masala. So you didn't revise the Masala. Sisters, how many of you revised the Masala?
Yeah.
How many? I can't see. How many people have got their hands up? Be honest. Huh? Three. Hmm?
So with the first hadith, when we revised it, when I heard that, I was already sold.
You were sold?
Yeah.
Yeah, but that's the whole point. You're not meant to be sold. You're meant to look into the Masala. Regardless of what the Masala is, okay? Now, when you're arguing a Masala, sure, in class, it doesn't mean that because you know the Masala from one angle that khalas, that's it. The benefit of a bahth is that you look at things from different angles. Okay? And this Masala, the whole reason why I gave you the Masala is because it was something that the scholars talk about a lot. Okay? And if you would have looked at the shuruh or any of the explanations or any of the Masala in general, then you would have understood that you guys were on the stronger opinion. And the sisters were on the weaker opinion. But you weren't able to defend the stronger opinion, although you were on the stronger opinion. Why? Because every mujtahid is not a musib. If every single mujtahid was a musib, that goes against the actual hadith. Because the hadith divided the mujtahidun into how many? Two. A musib and mukhti. Lafd al hadith. That's the strongest evidence that you have. The hadith says there's a mujtahid who's a musib, who has got the correct masala, and he's rewarded for two. And there's a hadith that is what? In the same hadith, he's a mukhti, he's made a mistake, lakin he's only rewarded for one. If there was no difference in the two, there'd be no difference. This one wouldn't have been given two rewards, and this one wouldn't have been given one. That's one. Also, from another angle, if you look at the guidance of the Sahaba, Ridwanullah ta'ala alayhim, there were incidents that were given to them or questions that they were asked and they refuted the correct, the mistaken answer. Do you not remember the mas'ala to do with a bint al-ibn and the ukht? And the ukht was given nisf, and the rest of, who was given the rest? The bint, I believe it was. And the other one of them was Mahjuba, I believe it was. Sah? One of them was Mahjuba. Abdullah, that question was asked to Abu Musa al-Ash'ari first and foremost. And then Abu Musa al-Ash'ari gave a hukum. And then they came to Ibn Mas'ud. Because Abu Musa al-Ash'ari radiallahu anhu said that Ibn Mas'ud is going to yuwafiqun, he's going to agree with me. And then he said what? لا إذا طللت. Then if I agree with him and I have made a mistake. طيب. Also another اجتهاد, another time عبد الله بن مسعود رضي الله عنه said هذا اجتهادي. If I made a mistake, the had يعني إن كان صوابا, if the اجتهاد فمن الله. And if it is a mistake, فمني ومن شيطان. Also from another angle, you would have known that it is impossible to give one hukum in one mas'ala. مثلا, a man comes to you in any اجتهاد and he says to you, listen, I said to my wife, أنتي طالق, أنتي طالق, أنتي طالق. Does it happen in three, يعني, do I include it? Do I take it as three طلاق or is there only one طلاق? اجتهد العلماء have given اجتهاد and they've said ثلاثة, so three طلقات, صح? Put that to one side. Other scholars have done اجتهاد and said, لا, طلقة واحدة, it is only one divorce. If we say every مجتهد is a مصيب, then there's going to be contradiction, تناقض, clear تناقض. Of course there's clear تناقض, because what is he meant to do now? If we say to him, listen, you can consider it as three طلاق, you can go and you're correct. You can also consider it as one and you can correct. It's not, يعني, it won't be what? It won't be beneficial to him. Also, the whole point of an hukum is that you can apply that hukum. If you give a mujtahid, if a mujtahid gives a hukum and he says, هذا حلال وهذا حرام. لكن it doesn't matter. كلنا مجتهدون ومصيبون. That is halal and that is haram. لكن all of us are مجتهدون. So you can take whichever opinion you want. معقول هذا? It's not معقول. It's not. طيب. As for the argument the sister said, the hadith about Banu Qurayda, صحيح. There was what? And Mubarak kind of drew the, يعني came close to it, which was, صحيح, there's ta'wil there. Okay. But that ta'wil, let's say at that particular time, they did not have any ijtihad to say this is the strong opinion or this is the stronger opinion. Leave that hadith in totality and go back to the clear-cut adilla with regards to the timing. Did Allah Jalla wa'ala not say, إِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ كَانَتْ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ الْكِتَابُ مَوْقُوتًا? Verily, the salah has been prescribed at prescribed fixed times upon the believers. So they should have applied that. So the ones that were correct are the ones that prayed on the way. The ones that were correct were the ones that prayed on the way. Why were they correct? Because that hadith, they had khilaf over it. صح? طيب, look beyond the hadith. There are evidences that say you should pray the salah on time. Anyhow, this is just an exercise. It doesn't really matter. Like the most important thing is when you're given a mas'ala, when you're given a mas'ala, you look into the mas'ala. That's the least that you can do. I know obviously that many of you were going to say that the stronger opinion is what? That he's not, exactly. So the sisters, all credit to them, they took the weaker opinion and defended it better than you. They did defend it better than you, didn't they? صح, they did. Even though if you had looked and revised, you would have easily been able to counter-attack their statements. Imam al-Shawkani says, rahimahullah, I'm going to read a few statements from the Imams regarding this hadith. Imam al-Shawkani said, rahimahullah, he's got a kitab called Ikshad al-Fuhul. He says, regarding that hadith, إِذَا الْشْتَهَدَ حَاكِمُ, he says, rahimahullah, فهذا الحديث يفيدك أن الحق واحد. هذا الحديث, this hadith, which hadith? إذا اجتهد حاكم. يفيدك, it gives you the benefits, you, that أن الحق واحد, that the حق is واحد, that the حق is one. وأن بعض المجتهدين, and that some مجتهدين يوافقه, that some مجتهدين are, يعني, upon the same opinion as that, as, يعني, in the correct opinion, as the hadith says. فيقال له, it is said, مصيب, يعني the one that gives the correct ruling and does ijtihad and gives the correct ruling, يقال له, it said to him, مصيب, he is the one that is correct. ويستحق أجرين, and he deserves two rewards. وبعض المجتهدون, بعض المجتهدين, some مجتهدين, يخالفه, that go against the hadith, meaning they've given the wrong حكم. يقال له, you say, it said to him, مخطئ, he's mistaken, يعني he hasn't given the correct ruling. واستحقاقه الأجر, and the fact that he has been given an أجر, لا يستلزم كونه مصيبا. It does not necessitate that he is correct. So the fact that he's been given a reward, it doesn't necessitate that he is what? Correct in his ijtihad. واسم الخطأ and the fact that the labeling him to be a mistake, labeling it to be a mistake, لا يستلزم قوله مصيبا واسم الخطأ عليه لا يستلزم أن يكون له أجر. The fact that he is being called المخطئ, it doesn't necessitate that he is also what, or the fact that he's been given an ajr and given the title of being given or given the wrong hukum, it does not mean that he has still attained the ajr that is for his ijtihad, and he still made a mistake. فمن قال, whoever says كل مجتهد مصيب, whoever says every mujtahid is correct, وجعل الحق متعددا, and makes the حق different, يعني one, two, three, different, whichever mas'ala is correct, or whichever opinion is correct, or whichever ijtihad is correct, whoever says that, بتعدد المجتهدين, فقد أخطأ وخالف الصواب. Like really, he had made a mistake and he has opposed the correct opinion. مخالفة ظاهرة, clear cut مخالفة. He has clearly opposed the opinion, the correct مسألة. فإن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, why? Because the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, جعل المجتهدين, he has made the مجتهدين قسمين. He has split the مجتهدين into two. قسما مصيبا وقسما مخطئا. He split them into two. He said, you've made a mistake, and you've what? Given the right hukum. وَلَوْ كَانَ كُلُّ وَاحِدٍ مُصِيبًا, and if every one of them was correct, وَلَمْ يَكُنْ لِهَذَا التَّقْسِيمَ مَعْنَى, لَمْ يَكُنْ لِهَذَا التَّقْسِيمَ مَعْنَى, if every one of them was correct, there would be no reason for saying that you are correct and you are mistaken. And there would be no reason for giving this one two ajr and giving that visa, that one, or this individual one ajr. Is understood? So the maqsood, anyhow, is don't suffice with what you learn in the matan. Always go back and revise the mas'ala. Any questions on that before we move on to taqleed? The Shaykh said, rahimahullah, at-taqleed ta'rifuhu. So taqleed, which is to blind follow a hukum. At-taqleed, يعني to blind follow a hukum. مثلاً, a alim says to you that this mas'ala is halal. And you say, طيب, جزاكالله خيراً. You take it as it is, meaning it is what? Halal. And you don't say to him, what is the dalil? He doesn't give you the dalil. Or you don't know the dalil. So on that note, the people are of three types. Mujtahid, متبع and مقلد. مجتهد, متبع, مقلد. The مجتهد is the one that is able to look into the kitab and the sunnah. He has fulfilled the conditions of ijtihad. He has fulfilled the conditions of ijtihad that we studied last week, and he's able to look into the Qur'an and the Sunnah and derive the correct ruling. The muttabi' is the one that takes an opinion or the fatwa of a alim, and he knows the evidences of that opinion or of that madhab or of that alim, and he understands these evidences, and he understands why it is stronger than the other opinion or the other madhab or the other alim. So he is in a manzila bayna manzilatayn. He is not a muqallid out and out, and he is not a mujtahid out and out. Questions up there? Write it down. Like. And then we have the muqallid. The muqallid is the one that adopts or takes a madhab or an opinion or the fatwa of a alim without knowing the evidence and without understanding the evidence, and without knowing why it is the stronger opinion. And without knowing why it is the stronger opinion that he has taken, or that his alim has taken. So the mujtahid, obviously, we've studied in the last chapter. The muttabi' can come underneath that, in the sense that he can take some of the rulings of Bab al-Ijtihad or the mujtahid, in the sense that he is able to look into the haqq and take the haqq. But he also resembles the muqallid in some sort of way, because he is not an out and out mujtahid. And there are many scholars that give this sort of categorization of three: the mujtahid, the muttabi' and muqallid. Although the jumhur of the musuliyun, they say that either a person is a mujtahid or a muqallid. A mujtahid or a muqallid. So the Shaykh rahimahullah, in this mas'ala, in this bab, which is the last chapter of the book that we're studying, he's going to mention some masail. He says, rahimahullah, at-taqlidu ta'rifu, the taqlid, the ta'rifu of taqlid or blind following is, at-taqlidu lughatan is wad'u shay fil unuqi muhiyatan bihi kal-qalada. So taqlid is to put something around the neck, which goes all around the neck, like a handle, where you can kind of lead off from it. So it covers something that covers the whole angle, or the whole neck, like a necklace. And istilahan, it is called ittiba'u man laysa qawluhu hujjatan, to follow the one, ittiba'u, to follow man laysa, the one that his statement is not a proof. To follow the one whose statement, whose opinion, whose madhab is not proof. Then the Shaykh rahimahullah, he talks about, or he explains this ta'rif. He says, فَخَرَجَ بِقَوْلِنَا مَنْ لَيْسَ قَوْلُهُ حُجَّةً. So the last part, مَنْ لَيْسَ قَوْلُهُ حُجَّةً, the meaning behind that is, or this excludes what? He says, اتِّبَاعُ النَّبِي صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهُ وَسَلَّمُ. It excludes following the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. Because following the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is not taqleed. It is called ittiba'. But lakin, why? Because qawluhu hujja. Here it says qawluhu laysa hujja. Taqleed is when you follow a person whose statement is not a hujja. Lakin the statement of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is it not a hujja? Laysa hujja. It's a form of hujja. Therefore it is not called taqleed. It is called what? Al-ittiba'. وَاتِّبَاعُ أَهْلِ الْإِجْمَاعِ. And also to follow those people who have ijma', meaning a group of scholars. Ahlul ilm, they give ijtihad, and then you follow that ijma'. So here it is, اِتِّبَاعُ الدَّلِيلِ الْإِجْمَاعِ, to follow the dalil of ijma'. Following ijma' is not also what? Taqlid, blind following. Why not? Because ijma' is a proof itself. Excellent. وَاتِّبَاعُ قَوْلِ الصَّحَابِ. And also, following the statement of the Sahabi, إِذَا قُلْنَا أَنَّ قَوْلَهُ حُجَّةٌ. If we say that his qawl is a hujjah, إِذَا قُلْنَا أَنَّ, إِذَا قُلْنَا إِنَّ. If it says أَنَّ, then put the hamza on the bottom. إِذَا قُلْنَا إِنَّ. Anything that comes, when إِنَّ comes after قُلْ أو مَقُولُ قَوْلُ, then it is إِنَّ. إِذَا قُلْنَا إِنَّ قَوْلَهُ حُجَّةٌ. If we say that the qawl of the sahab is a hujjah, and we studied that the Shaykh rahimahullah gives the stronger opinion that it is, and that's the madhab of the Hanabila. طيب. فَلَا يُسَمَّ اتِّبَاعُ شَيْءٍ مِنْ ذَلِكَ تَقْلِيدًا لِأَنَّهُ اتِّبَاعٌ لِلْحُجَّةِ. The Shaykh says, فَلَا يُسَمَّ, it is not called اتِّبَاعُ شَيْءٍ مِنْ ذَلِكَ, following any of that, any of what? The statement of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ijma' and the qawl of the sahabi. Following any of that is not called what? It is not called taqleed. لماذا؟ لأنه اتباع الحجّة. Why? Because it is following the hujjah. It is following the proof. لكن قد يسمى تقليدا على وجه المجاز والتوسع. لكن it can be called taqleed when you're looking at it from a majaz point of view, metaphor point of view. Or لكن when you just want to, when you're saying it and you're not restricting your wording to the mustalahat or the terminology of the usuliyun. So you can call it. Also the Salaf rahmatullah alayhim, they would call taqleed ittiba', following. They would call, when they follow a certain alim, they would call it taqleed. Lakin in the terminology of the usul al-fiqh, la. So the Shaykh says, rahimahullah, mawadu' taqleed, where can taqleed take place? Yakunu taqleedu fi mawdi'ayni. Taqleed can take place in two places. Al-awwal an yakuna al-muqallidu amiyan. That first, who is it, or يعني, who is permissible, or man yasih lahu at-taqleed. You can also write, you know what it says, وَيَكُونُ تَقْلِيدُ فِي مَوْضِعَيْنِ. You can write on the side of it, مَنْ يَصِحُ لَهُ تَقْلِيدُ أو مَنْ يَجُوز لَهُ التَّقْلِيدُ أو أَنْ يُقَلِّدُ. So you can put it as a side title. The Shaykh says, rahimahullah, the first, تَقْلِيد goes into two places, or two types of individuals can do تَقْلِيد. He says, الأول, أَنْ يَكُونَ الْمُقَلِّدُ, if the مُقَلِّد, if the blind follower is what? عَامِيًا, he is a عَامِي. He doesn't know anything to do with Quran and Sunnah, evidence, عام, خاص, usul, fiqh, and evidence. But he doesn't know. لا يستطيع معرفته. He does not. He's not able to know the حكم. معرفة الحكم بنفسه. ففرضه تقليد. So he doesn't know the حكم of this particular one مسألة. He doesn't know the حكم of the مسألة. What should he do? He can do تقليد. فقال جل وعلا فسألوا أهل الذكر إن كنتم لا تعلمون. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it wajib for him to what? To follow the what? أهل الذكر. To follow the people of remembrance. Meaning the people of أهل العلم. طيب. Then the Shaykh says رحمه الله ويقلد. And who is he allowed to do تقليد of? ويقلد, he follows أفضل من يجده. The best of those that he can find. علما وورعا. فإن تساوى عنده اثنان خير بينهما. So he says, the Shaykh rahimahullah is saying that he has to choose the most virtuous and the most knowledgeable and the pious one out of the two individuals, the two mujtahideen. Lakin if both are exactly the same, then he can choose whoever, whichever one he, or whoever he wants to go to. طيب. الثاني أن يقع للمجتهد. So the first person that can do taqlid is who? The Ammi. The Shaykh says rahimahullah, the second, الثاني, أن يقع للمجتهد, that the مجتهد, he comes across, or something, حادثة, something happens. He is presented with a مسألة. A حادثة, حادثة, a مسألة. So you write, حادثة, a مسألة. حادثة, a مسألة. تقتضي الفورية. And it necessitates a quick حكم. They need a quick حكم there and then. ولا يتمكن من النظر فيها فيجوز له تقليد حينئذ ولا يتمكن من النظر فيها. He's not able to look into the mas'ala, look into the evidence of this mas'ala and this mas'ala and this opinion, and what is the opinion, what is the stronger opinion here, and so on. He's not able to look at it. بحث يعني. فيجوز له, what is permissible, التقليد. Then what is permissible for him is التقليد. Is that understood? So these two scenarios, the Shaykh says rahimahullah, that is permissible for the mujtahid, on the first one, the ami, and secondly, the mujtahid that doesn't know the hukum. He doesn't know the hukum. And he needs it quickly. What can he do? He can blind follow another person. Also, another third one maybe is, if he doesn't know the hukum of a particular mas'ala, he can do taqleed. He's a mujtahid, like in this particular mas'ala, he doesn't know the hukum of it. So he's not allowed to give a ruling. Why? He doesn't know the hukum. Lakin he can follow another person who knows, or he believes and knows the hukum. طيب. طيب. Ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullah has obviously شرح كتاب العلم. He has a statement for talking about the talib al-ilm. Because the talib al-ilm is not a mujtahid, and he's not what? Muqallid. He's not a ammi. So the Shaykh says رحمه الله من عثيمين طالب العلم المبتدئ في العلم يجب عليه البحث عن الدليل بقدر إمكانه. The طالب العلم, that is the مبتدئ, that has started off seeking knowledge, or that has been seeking knowledge for some time, يجب عليه البحث, it is واجب upon him to do بحثي, to research the مسألة, عن الدليل, with evidence, بقدر إمكانه, as much as he can, as much as he can, لأن المطلوبة, because what is needed is what? لأن المطلوبة الوصول إلى الدليل. لأن what is needed or what is requested and what is required is to reach the correct دليل. ولأجل أن يحصل له التمرن على طلب الأدلة وكيفية الاستدلال. And also, so not only is it because he knows the evidence or he reaches the evidence and he knows of comes to the correct ruling, لكن also it is important that he gets used to and exercises himself in trying to look at how to benefit from the evidence, how to search for evidence. And that's the whole reason why I gave you that exercise last week, so that you know that when you're given a mas'ala, don't just say this is the stronger opinion. Look at it from the other side as well. And sometimes mashayikh do that, whereby they give an opinion and then this one defends A, qawl A, and this one defends qawl B. It may be that the ones that are defending qawl A are upon qawl B, and the ones that are defending qawl B are actually upon qawl A. Sah? Like now, mujtahid musib. I knew that the majority of you, about 99% of you, were going to say that the mujtahid is not every mujtahid is a musib. So if I expect, the exercise would have died there and then. Because all of you said what at the beginning? That he's not musib. Khalas. That meant we would have gone on to the next masala, sah? Like, what have you missed out there? Looking at different evidences. Why is this hadith an evidence? Why is it not an evidence? This other hadith that points towards Bani Qurayda, why were not both of them? Why are both of them not correct? Why can't we use them? So when the student of knowledge gets used to these types of evidences and how to use these evidences and how to answer the opinion that they're upon the other opinion, it gives them exercise on how to kayfiyatul istidlal, how to use evidences. فَيَكُونُ Then he becomes فَيَكُونُ سَائِغًا إِلَى اللَّهِ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى. Meaning the student of knowledge, he becomes a person who is on the path to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala عَلَى بَصِيرَةٍ وَبُرْهَانٍ, upon insight and knowledge. وَلَا يَجُوزُ لَهُ التَّقْلِيدُ إِلَّا لِلضَّرُورَةٍ. And it is not permissible for him to do taqleed, to blind follow, except if there's a dire need. كَمَا لَوْ بَحَثَ فَلَمْ يَسْتَطِعْ الْوُصُولَ إِلَى نَتِيجَةٍ. For example, if he actually tries, researching, and he doesn't know the stronger opinion, then he can ask and follow, blind follow. أو حدث له حادثة تتطلب الفورية. Or something happens to him and they require a hukum there and then. Same with the mujtahid. A mas'ala comes and he doesn't have time to go and look into the mas'ala. طيب. So that is just a faida on the student of knowledge. Then the Shaykh says, "Rahimahullah, واشترط بعضهم لجواز تقليد أن لا يكون المسألة تكون المسألة في أصول الدين التي يجب اعتقادها لأن العقائد يجب الجزم فيها والتقليد فيها إنما يفيد الظن وراجح أن ذلك ليس بشرط." The Shaykh Rahimahullah is now talking to another mas'ala, referring to another mas'ala, which is تقليد. We've already said that الأحكام العملية, Salah, Zakah, Hajj, and so on, taqleed is permissible, sah? We've already established that taqleed is permissible. Like in the Shaykh is saying now, with regards to some of them say that it is a condition that a person cannot follow, blind follow with regards to aqeedah. They cannot blind follow with regards to aqeedah. And this goes up back to a mas'ala which Ahlul Sunnah differ with Ahlul Bid'ah, the Asha'ir and the Mu'tazil, which is awwal wajib. What is the first wajib? Al-Iman, the believers believe Tawheed, Al-Iman Billah subhanahu wa ta'ala, huwa awwal wajib. Lakin Ahlul Bid'ah, they say that the awwal wajib is another wal istidlal, that you have to look, and you have to find evidences, and you have to ponder and so on and so forth before you believe. So the Shaykh said to do taqleed in masail of usul al-deen, in masail of aqeedah. Why? Because aqeedah, you have to be certain of it. You have to be certain of it. Lakin the Shaykh says, وَرَاجِحُ Lakin the stronger opinion that is that it is not what, and ليس بشرط, it is not a condition. لعموم قوله تعالى, due to the verse of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Ask the people of knowledge if you do not know. Then the Shaykh says, وَالْآيَةُ فِي سِيَاقِ إِثْبَاتِ الرِّسَالَةِ. And the verse was talking about what? Establishing the prophethood of the prophets. Allah Jalla wa'ala says, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِن قَبْلِكَ إِلَّا رِجَالًا نُوحِي إِلَيْهِمْ فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. The beginning part of the verse talks about what? The revelation and the fact that Allah Jalla wa'ala sent down messengers. And is that not to do with aqeedah? Illa bala, is to do with aqeedah. So he says that the verse talks about aqeedah. Therefore, how can you say you cannot ask or you cannot blind follow in aqeedah if the whole mas'ala, the verse was actually referring to Allah Jalla wa'ala sending down messengers and then commanding us to ask them. فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ ذِكْرٍ كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Because the whole, what is that? What do you understand from that? فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ ذِكْرٍ كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Ask the people of knowledge if you do not know. What do you understand from that? What is the mafhum?
You don't know.
You don't know? Okay, what else? Okay, excellent. What else?
You're asking to get the thing to take.
Excellent. You're getting, you're asking, because you don't know, you're asking to get an opinion that you can believe in. صح. Therefore, it is not a condition that you cannot blind follow in aqeedah. وَهُوَ مِنْ أُصُولِ الدِّينِ. And it is from the أُصُولُ الدِّينِ, يعني the risala, the prophethood. The prophethood of the Prophet ﷺ, and those before the Prophet ﷺ. وَلِأَنَّ الْعَامِ, because the عَامِ as well, لَا يَتَمَكْنُ مِنْ مَعْرِفَةِ الْحَقِّ بِأَدِلَّتِهِ. The عَامِ in general, he might not be able to know the correct evidences and search for the correct evidences. فَإِذَا تَعَذَّرَ عَلَيْهِ مَعْرِفَةُ الْحَقِّ, if he is not able to look into the حَقِّ, بِنَفْسِهِ, يعني he's not able to see, know the حَقِّ, لَمْ يَبْقَ إِلَّا التَّقْلِيدِ. The only thing that is permissible for him is what? تقليد لقوله تعالى فاتقوا الله ما استطعتم. That's all he's able to do. The army does not have the ability to look into the Quran and the Sunnah and divide rulings. Nor does he have the ability to, well, he should have the ability. Every Muslim should seek knowledge. Why? Because طلب العلم فريضة على كل مسلم. لكن if he doesn't, then he should what? Ask. And when he asks, he should accept that opinion and believe in it. طيب. So that is that masala. Then the Shaykh says, rahimahullah, وَأَنْوَاعُ. نعم. أَنْوَاعُ التَّقْلِيدِ. Now the Shaykh, rahimahullah, is talking about the types of taqleed. First he talked about the ta'rif of taqleed. Then, who is allowed to make taqleed. Then the masala we last studied. And now anwa'u taqleed. The Shaykh says, rahimahullah, at-taqleedu naw'an. Amun wa khas. Taqleed is of two. Am wa khas. Taqleed, that is what? Am and khas. The Shaykh says, rahimahullah, fal'amu, as for the am, the masala that is am, he said, or the taqleed that is am, an yaltazima madhhaba mu'ayyana ya'khudhu bi rukhasihi wa azaimihi fi jami' umur dinihi. What is the meaning of taqleed am? It is أَيَّلْتَزِمَ مَذْهَبًا, that he sticks to one madhab, مُعَيَّنًا, one specific madhab. يَأْخُذُ بِرُخَسِهِ, he takes the concessions of that madhab. وَعَزَائِمِهِ, and also the non-concessions, the restricted masail that he has to do for that, for any one ibadah. For example, praying salah at his time, fasting during the month of Ramadan. In the beginning, I don't know if we studied at the beginning, رُخْسَ and عَزِيمَ, did we study رُخْسَ and عَزِيمَ? Yeah. Rukhsa simply means the concessions. Like for example, when a person is traveling in Ramadan, he's allowed to what? Shorten his salah and break his fast. That is a rukhsa, a concession. Like, what is a azima? Azima is like, for example, now we're not traveling, we cannot shorten our prayers. When we are not traveling, we have to fast if it is Ramadan. صح? That is azima. That is the azima. Now, مثلا, we're not traveling, are we? Can we combine our salah out of the blue? Just for the sake of it? La. Lakin, so that is called azima. When we're traveling, can we combine our salah? That is called rukhsa. So rukhsa are the concessions in the sharia. And azaim are, or azima is the opposite to that. طيب. في جميع أمور دينه. So that is the first type of taqleed. It is that a person restricts himself to one madhab, without looking at whether it's the stronger opinion or the weaker opinion or anything like that. The Shaykh says, rahimahullah, وَقَدْ اخْتَلَفَ الْعُلَمَاءُ فِيهِ, and the scholars have differed on the ruling of this. They've differed on the ruling of this. طيب. The Shaykh says, rahimahullah, فَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ حَكَى وُجُوبَهُ. Some of the, so now, مِنْهُمْ مَنْ حَكَى. You know where it says وَقَدْ اخْتَلَفَ الْعُلَمَاءُ? Yeah. On the side of it, right? حُكْمُ الْتِزَامِ مَذْهَبًا مُعَيَّنًا. Or هل يجوز الالتزام بمذهب معين؟ هل يجوز الالتزام بمذهب معين؟ The Sheikh says رحمه الله فمنهم من حكى وجوبه Put قاف 1 What does قاف 1 stand for? قول أول قاف 1 فمنهم من حكى وجوبه Some of them say that it is They've mentioned and narrated the obligation of it That it's obligatory What is obligatory? Sticking to one madhab Why? لتعذر الاجتهاد في المتأخرين لتعذر الاجتهاد في المتأخرين Why? Because the متأخرين Those that came after The latter part of this ummah The 8th, 9th, 10th century and so on اجتهاد is non-existent they say Because they say the bab of اجتهاد has been closed So because the bab of اجتهاد has been closed They can only what stick to They can only possibly follow one madhab. And some of them actually restrict it or limit it to what these four madhabs. Then the Shaykh says, Rahimahullah, so that is the first opinion. وَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ حَكَى تَحْرِيمَهُ And from them are those that say it is haram. طيب ومنهم من حكى تحريمه That is the قاف 2 لما فيه من الالتزام المطلق لاتباع غير النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم He's given the تعليل Okay So You know earlier on where, a few seconds ago Where the Sheikh says لتعذر الاجتهاد That is called a تعليل A reasoning. It is not a dalil, or it can be considered a part of a dalil, or some sort of dalil. Like, obviously, it is not dalil from the Quran and the Sunnah. And then here he says what? لِمَا فِيهِ مِنَ الْتِزَامِ الْمُطْلَقِ لِاتِّبَاعِ غَيْرِ النَّبِي صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ That is also a ta'lil. He says, why is it haram? It is haram because if we say that you have to follow a specific madhab, then you're making it binding upon people Blind following, total blind following or total following of a person other than the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And as you know, the only person that is wajib for us to follow in everything that he says and does is who? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then he mentions a statement by Shaykh al-Islam rahimahullah. He says, يقول شيخ الإسلام تيمية رحمه الله إن في القول بوجوب طاعة غير النبي sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The statement of saying or the opinion that says it is wajib to follow, other than the opinion of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, someone other than the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, في كل أمره ونهيه, in all of his statements, all of his commandments and prohibitions, وهو خلاف الإجماع, and that actually contradicts the إجماع, وجوازه, يعني هو خلاف الإجماع. On your where it says, وهو خلاف الإجماع, whoa, is there a whoa before the هو on your matan? Yeah. Well, it would have made a bit more sense to say huwa khilaful ijma'. It contradicts the ijma'. But anyhow, khilaful ijma', it contradicts the ijma'. Wa jawazuhu, and to say it is permissible, fihi ma fihi. Wa jawazuhu. So he says, it is definitely not permissible to say what? It is wajib. Lakin he says, even saying it is permissible, fihi ma fihi, there's still a lot can be said basically. Have you understood? He's saying, Rahimah, Shaykh al-Islam is saying, to make it binding upon people to blindly follow one person, other than the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it is what? Contradicts ijma'. And if it contradicts the ijma', is that permissible or not permissible? Impermissible. Let alone wajib, even saying wajawazuh, even saying it is permissible, fihi ma fihi. He says in it is what is in it. Yani saying that a lot can be said. Meaning that even that is a A weak opinion, he says, rahimahullah. Well, it can be understood. وقال, and he says, rahimahullah, من التزم مذهبا معينا, whoever restricts himself to a specific madhab. So now he's talking about another mas'ala. He's talking about another mas'ala. Lakin, before we go to this second mas'ala, the mas'ala that the sheikh is talking about, in which some say it is wajib and some say it is what? Haram. That is to do with tamadhub. Is it permissible to follow a madhab or not? And there are a few points that we need to write down. وَقُلْ رَبِّ زِدْنِي